Asha from J-Hub Osmania University, with women taking the steering into their hands and making the Chandrayaan-2 a very successful mission. While the whole country is celebrating, today we have with us Dr. Shanti Priya and Dr. Rukmini, Department of Astronomy, Osmania University, to shed some more light on the intricacies of the Chandrayaan-2. Ma'am, I would like to begin by trying to know, what is the importance of the space missions to the mankind?
Vipasha, good morning to you. We have been seeing that man is curious about knowing his environment and exploring his environment since the age of stone ages. And people wonder, when there are so many problems on Earth, like we have so much of scarcity of food, land, resources, as well as a proper habitable life on Earth itself, and why should one spend so much of time, money and energy for space explorations? But when we look into past and present achievements, or as such I said, many accidents as well as achievements in the space programs, we find that it becomes very much important. For example, it is observed that most of the new technological developments like a GPS, or for instance medical kits like BP and sugar detection machines, and networking interfaces, even the laptop, the mouse and the laptop, they were all inadvertently designed for space explorations. They were not initially developed for manhood on life on Earth. And apart from this, there are many other reasons. Like for example, there is a threat on the Earth from near Earth asteroids and comets. These are all called as NEAs, so NEOs in general. So we, in the past, we have seen that there are theories that dinosaurs have become extinct few billion years ago because of an asteroid strike, as well as in the recent past, for example, Tunguska event and Chelyabinsk event, wherein a meteor or a small side asteroid would explode in the atmosphere of the Earth, can create a catastrophe which is equivalent to that of any nuclear explosion. And that can wash out any kind of life form on Earth itself. So we find that not only this, in most of the space explorations, like for example in the ISS, International Space Stations, they conduct so many medical experiments to test the ability of new technology or new kind of medication which can cure most of the incurable diseases on Earth and enhance the lifespan of humankind on Earth. And see, if I start speaking, there is an endless list. You find that initially, not only the International Forum, even the Indian Space Agency had thought about exploring space for basic reasons like mass communication, remote sensing, weather monitoring, and telemedicine, for example, and exploring the Earth's environment, finding out the resources and utilization of resources on Earth, and then going beyond the Earth.
But what do you think the role of India in such missions?
See, India being a developing country can put a mark in the face of the Earth by going parallel with all the technological developments. Yeah. Apart from the defense research which is going on to protect the space environment, the satellites which we have sent in the space, we need to protect them. We are using them right now. Your media is using the space satellites to transmit all these communications which we are doing now. And in order to have a supremacy or a safeguarding our own space environment, we need to be at a higher technological level in par with any other international country. So India needs to be following that rule. And it is going ahead. I'm happy that it's going ahead with that.
Okay, thank you. As we all know that the main difference between the two missions, Chandrayaan-1 and Chandrayaan-2, is that Chandrayaan-1 made a very crash landing, but Chandrayaan-2 will make a soft landing. What do you think are the other major differences between the two missions?
Actually, when I would like to talk on that, when Chandrayaan-1 was sent to the space, it was a moon impact probe that was left onto the moon. Actually, it's not a landing or anything. It just crash landed, and it had a free fall of around 30 minutes. So during that, it continuously has done the recording. So what would happen, it was like setting path for the other mission that we are going ahead now, Chandrayaan-2. So it has recorded all the procedures, what would the impact be. And that impact was like we putting our Indian tricolor flag onto the moon surface. It was the fourth country to do that after US, Russia and China. So the probe had tricolor painted all over, and the point of impact was given the name as Jawahar Point. So that was a way to understand how a rover have to be placed on the surface of the moon. So based on that recording and the results that we got, they have designed Chandrayaan 2. So the major difference between Chandrayaan 1 and 2 is that Chandrayaan 1 was the first setback for India, first of such kind of exploration, wherein we had to reach the outer space and we were exploring the outer space for the first time. And initially we have taken help of other countries, but most of the payloads which were used were, 5 of them were indigenous and other 6 were from other countries. And Chandrayaan 1 has done around 3,400 orbits around the moon and has given almost 500 images per day. So using that we have done 3D mapping of moon, 3D atlas mapping, and we could know the near and far surfaces of the moon, and also we could get an idea of chemical and mineralogy of the moon, and the major detection was that of hydroxyl and water, and that led to the scientific achievement of Chandrayaan 1, and that continued with Chandrayaan 2. So the major goal of Chandrayaan 2 is, like, we are going ahead with Chandrayaan 2 to go into deeper exploration of the existence of water and to understand the surface better. And along with finding the water, its major thing is also to study the fossils of the shadowed regions of the craters, wherein we would know the actual existence and the evolution of solar system as such. The major difference is, like, the weight of the objects where Chandrayaan 1 was used to, it was lifted off using a PSLV, and Chandrayaan 2 using a GSLV. More payloads in Chandrayaan 2, more instruments, 13 instruments it is carrying, plus one of NASA. And that's why it is more interesting than that of Chandrayaan 1.
So just now you told the terms like PSLV and GSLV. Would you like to describe more about it? What is the difference between both of them?
Yeah, PSLV is like Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, and GSLV is Geosynchronous Satellite Launch Vehicle. Both are launch vehicles that their role is the same. They are used to launch the rockets. So PSLV is like takes the satellites to a certain level wherein they are placed near the lower Earth orbits, mostly near the polar regions. And when they are taking the readings from the polar regions, we have to take the data from different areas, different research centers. But when you go to GSLV, for example, PSLV can take up to payloads of around 1400 kgs or to 1700 kgs. Whereas if we come to GSLV, it can lift up to a weight of around 2500 to 4000 kgs. The Mark 3, which we are talking about in Chandrayaan 2, is made to lift around 4000 kgs. So in geocentric, it is mostly used to place the satellites in higher orbits, higher elliptical orbits. And the satellites are placed at a certain point, like INSAT, which we have, mostly communication satellites are used to lift off by GSLV. And the major advantage is we can collect the data from a certain point. Wherever we are launching, from there we can collect the data at a certain point where we can launch, which is not different from that of PSLV.
Okay. So why do you think the scientists prefer different types of engine in the different stages of the launch?
Different engines means, we are sending certain weighted instruments, 13 payloads or 11 payloads with 1400 to 4000 kgs of weight has to be sent to the outer space. So it needs an initial thrust.
Program
So to have that initial thrust, they use certain vehicles, they use certain propellants to lift that, give that thrust, initial thrust, to escape the Earth's gravitational velocity. So to give that, TSLV has a certain amount of stages and GSLV has a certain amount of stages. Like TSLV has 6 stages where it gives the initial push, and then after reaching a certain point, they just get dislocated from the system. So to give that initial thrust, a few of the vehicles are used which may be solid or cryogenic. So initially they use solid propellants, and after reaching a certain point, that is into the deeper space, they use cryogenic or liquid hydrogen and oxygen engines. Okay.
So what is the role of this solid and cryogenic fuels in
These engines are made to hold the weight of the payloads and that of the rockets. The weight of these will be equivalent to that, so that it can get that lift, the initial upper thrust. The solid engines give that upper thrust to reach to the higher extent, initial speed to lift up the rockets. So the solids are for that, solid engines are for that, to give that speed and to place that in that orbit, whichever it is, it has to be placed. Liquid engine, because when we go to the higher atmospheres or higher space, we need lesser weight elements or engines, so that it can it is like hydrogen is a very costly gas, right? Yeah. So once we reach there, it has to use the fuels efficiently to reach our goals. So there they use cryogenic fuels or engines.
Ma'am, can you please describe the timeline and the different phases of Chandrayaan 2?
Initially, the Chandrayaan 2 was planned to be launched on 15th of July, but because of the technical snag, as is said, in the fuel chambers, so it was rescheduled on 22nd July. So we are happy that it went as per the schedule, but it's not like, see, the distance between Earth and Moon is about 4 lakh kilometers. So it's not a single straight path to travel from Earth to Moon. So it has various stages. Earth is a huge body, celestial body, and Moon is also a huge celestial body. And you need to carry a small rocket carrying all these satellites and payloads, escaping Earth's gravity, and then get trapped into the Moon's gravity and land sufficiently with the help of the lander. Now, for this, there are a number of maneuvers which take place. So in the first stage, the launch is made to carry the rocket and the satellite with all its members till an altitude wherein it can start orbiting around the Earth. So there will be a Earth orbital phase through which it has to be reached, and that would take about 20 to 28 days, and it is expected, I think, around August of 13th, it is expected to cross that orbital phase. And then it needs to keep on orbiting around the Earth. Multiple maneuvers are done to increase its altitude from the Earth and increase its ellipticity. As it increases its ellipticity around the Earth, it can reach a stage which is called as lunar trajectory transit. So once it reaches that second stage, it is pushed into the gravitational region of Moon. So then it starts orbiting around the Moon. So the third stage would be in the lunar orbit phase. And within that, it has to reduce its altitude towards the Moon, increase the distance from Earth, and reach closer to the Moon. So the fourth stage would be once the lander reaches, say, the approximated distance is about 100 kilometers above the surface of the Moon. So once it reaches that area, it has to separate the orbiter has to separate itself from the lander. So the lander carrying the rover would be separated from the orbiter at a particular altitude of about 100 kilometers. So the next, about fourth stage would be the lander de-boosting itself, its speed, and slowly approaching the surface of the Moon, and then land, provide a soft landing on the surface of the Moon. That would be the one. And the last and the final stage would be the ejection of the rover, releasing the rover onto the lunar terrain. So these are broadly the 5 different stages through which the mission has to go before it even conducts any scientific observations or experiments on the lunar surface.
Okay. So what are the scientific payloads which are in the case of, which are used in the case of Chandrayaan-2?
Okay, there are about 14 payloads as Shanti has told. So basically we have three major blocks of instruments which are carrying all these payloads. So you have an orbiter, and you have a lander, and you have a rover.
Yeah.
So the orbiter is equipped with 8 instruments, and lander with 4, and then rover with 2 of the instruments. The major function of all these instruments is to map the terrain of the moon using various techniques. So there are radar, there are going to be radar techniques, there are going to be imaging techniques, there are going to be spectroscopes, there are going to be X-ray spectroscopes. So we find that some of the instruments, if I can list out some of the instruments to you, there are about, as I said, there are about 8 instruments on the orbiter. There is something called as terrain mapping camera, which was initially installed in even in Chandrayaan 1 mission. But here it is a miniaturized version of the same camera. So its duty is to make a 3D mapping on the terrain of the lunar south pole region. So it is a privilege for Indian community that the ISRO is sending our lander or sending an orbiter mostly focused over the south polar region of the moon, which was studied during various other space missions, various other missions, lunar missions by other countries, but landing was never done within this region. So this south polar region is supposed to be a shadowed region containing craters with most of the shadowed region where sunlight would not be, approximately never would receive any sunlight. And on the surface of the moon, it's like wherever you get a daylight, a sunlight, the temperatures are about 125 degrees centigrade. So hardly any liquid water would be available during that, in those regions.
Okay.
And in the shadowed region, you don't need to wait till the night. Even in the shadowed region, the temperature goes up to minus 150 degrees centigrade. So there is a high chance of detecting frozen ice on the surface or subsurface regions. So this 3D mapping camera would try to map the whole of the south polar region so that it can create a proper understanding of the terrain structure. Where are the craters, where are the boulders, where are the mountains, and where are the plains, which would be useful for future such missions. Not just for the future, but even for the lander, which is going to be landing onto the surface of the moon. So the second equipment which is there in the orbiter is a CLASS, Chandrayaan-2 Large Area Soft X-ray Spectrometer. So there is a concept called as X-ray fluorescence. There is a principle wherein the X-ray fluorescence of different compositions which are available on the terrain are detected by this X-ray detector, and the chemical elemental compositions are estimated. And then there is something called as X-ray solar monitor. So this would try to study what kind of solar radiation which is falling onto the lunar terrain is being reflected back onto the Earth. Its major duty is there. So the solar radiations are the high energy particles which are being emitted from the coronae of the sun, the upper regions of the sun's atmosphere. When they are falling onto the surface of the moon, they are also being reflected. But we see that only 20% of the radiation is being reflected, rest of the 80% is being absorbed within the lunar surface. So trying to analyze how much is the amount of radiance is the job of this X-ray solar monitor.
Okay.
And then we have Orbiter High Resolution Camera, OHRC. Its duty is to keep on scanning the surface and determine where is the most suitable landing site for the lander which is going to be dropped. And then the fifth one is IIRS, Imaging Infrared Spectrometer. So, like I said, the major requirement for this mission is to detect light, detect water, and study the mineralogy to find the resources for further missions. Like, if you want to send a future Chandrayaan mission or a Gaganyaan mission, a moon can be a stopping stage for you, a one stop for you, for further future space mission. Space travel. So you need to have abundant resources which can be supporting the manned space missions, and you need sufficient air and water which are necessary for sustainability of that kind of manned missions on the lunar surface. So IIRS would be definitely used for detecting water on the surface and subsurface layers, and determining the mineralogy on the surface to estimate the resources which are available on the surface of the moon. And then there is a dual frequency synthetic aperture radar, which also, using the radio techniques, maps the southern polar region. And then, see, some of the regions, the surface regions, are accessible using visible and X-ray kind of wave bands. But when you want to study at more and more lower depths of the surface, like you want to go to a few hundreds of kilometers subsurface of the moon, we are speculating that there won't be that much of difficulty from the solar irradiation or the cosmic radiation entering into such depths. So those are the specific regions where manned space missions can provide a landing place or a stopping place for a useful habitation. The resources would be there, and it would be more secured, and it's a foreign terrain. You must have seen, the moon is completely covered with craters and boulders. So even now, as we are speaking, there are a number of smaller asteroids or smaller, bigger meteoroids, chunks, falling onto the moon every second. So you don't want your costly technologically developed mission to face such difficulties once they land onto the moon as a one-stop, going ahead for a deeper space explorations. So you need to provide a secured kind of stop for further manned missions. So these deeper layers, subsurface layers, can provide that kind of facility. So to map such deeper layers, subsurface layers, this aperture radio spectroscopy is done. And then there is an instrument, seventh instrument, called as CHASE-2. So Chandrayaan Atmospheric Composition Explorer. We are benefited with the atmosphere of the Earth, and our Earth's atmosphere is protecting us from the tremendously strong radiation which is coming from sun in ultraviolet and X-rays. Every second, millions of such solar particles and cosmic ray radiation particles are entering into the Earth's atmosphere. We are only witnessing them as aurorae near the south and north polar regions. In the absence of Earth's atmosphere, I am sure that the intensity of X-ray radiations, UV radiations, can remove the sign of life form on the Earth, actually. We are already seeing that there is no life form on Moon, there is no life form on Mars or Venus. That is not just because of the carbon dioxide layer which is existing on Mars and Venus, but also because of absence of atmosphere on most of the other kinds of terrains in the solar system. So we find that it is high need to understand what is the effect or what is the impact of any kind of activity on sun taking place on a thin atmosphere, whatever thin atmosphere is existing on the moon. We are speculating there. So there is a, we understand that there is a weak magnetic field and there is a weak ionosphere or the exosphere which is existing on the upper layers of the moon, and it can be influenced by the solar radiations, the high energy particles which are coming from the solar radiations. And in order to study what is the gradient of these intensities, we need to have a particular experiment which is to be done. That is going to be done by this atmospheric composition explorer. And then we have a dual frequency radio scanner, which is basically studying for the same purpose, lunar ionospheric regions. So these are the 8 instruments which are there only installed in the orbiter. And the orbiter is going to do this job of using all these 8 instruments for overall 1 year while moving around 100 by 100 kilometers around the South Pole. Its job is that. And apart from this, the lander is consisting of 4 payloads, 3 which are indigenously built and 1 is in collaboration with US. The first one is called as RAMBHA. It's actually radio anatomy of moon-bound hypersensitive spectroscope. It is mostly for ionospheric and atmospheric studies. So the lander, as it undergoes transition, like ma'am has said, in Chandrayaan 1, the moon impact probe, while it was landing, it would have been mapping the different layers of its atmosphere. As there is a change in the altitude, you want to know what are the gradient, what is the temperature gradient, what is the pressure gradient of the ions, what is the elemental gradient which is available, composition available in these layers of depth, altitudes. So the same job is being carried out by this instrument in the lander. So it will measure the electron density, the plasma density. It will also measure the temperature variation as the lander lands from above, from the orbiter onto the surface of the moon. So we have two more equipment indigenously built. One is the CHAST, Chandrayaan Surface Thermophysical Experiment. So its work is also the same. It would try to find out what is the temperature gradient, but basically on the terrain, not during its transit from the orbiter to the surface of the moon. Then we have ILSA, Instrument for Lunar Seismic Activity. So planetary bodies or solar system bodies, they look like a single big huge chunk of solid. These are having liquid cores within them. So we are assuming that there is a differential rotation taking place inside the core and then to the mantle and to the crust. So these create a lot of quakes even onto the surface of the moon. There are seismic activities which are detected on the surface of the moon also during the previous lunar missions. So we need to be sure about our landing site, we need to be sure about our single stop for further deep space missions. So you know, to do that, we need to have a proper idea about what are the seismic activities, to what intensities these activities occur, and what are the complications which can arise due to these things. So in order to monitor that, this seismic activity instrument is installed in the lander. And there is a passive component which is LRA, Laser Retro Reflector Array, which is being sent by US. And it is basically to measure the dynamical status between the Earth and Moon. You want to know what is the average distance of separation between Earth and Moon, how it changes with time, how dynamically it is varying with the different phases of the Moon around the Earth. And which is very important when you want to actually plan any lunar mission. See, we have a small window of 6th to 7th July earlier. But because of the rescheduling to from 15th July, the reschedule was from 22nd July. So instead of landing window of 6th to 7th September, the landing window has been narrowed down to 7th September only. Because you need the landing spot to be in the day side, and the day side for a moon is only for 14 days. So you need your solar panels to be always be powered by the sun continuously during your experiment, and you want the information which is being gathered by your probes to be sent on to your receiver. The rover sends it to the lander sends it to the orbiter, and the orbiter sends it to the stations on the Earth. So in order to efficiently gather the data, even if you want to control the distance between Earth and Moon is about 4 lakh kilometers. So even if you want to control a rover, it would take about 5 seconds, minimum of 5 seconds, for you to realize if the information, if the instruction has been followed by the rover or not. So all the information which is being gathered and being sent can be done if you are sending your probe within that window time, where the landing site is suitably placed with respect to Earth and Moon positions. So to do that, this kind of device is very much important. So you need precise measurements as to when the position of the Earth and Moon would be placed in this solar system in different phases of the Moon's orbit. And then there is a rover, and the rover contains two payloads. One is Alpha Particle X-ray Spectrometer. Its duty is also to find out the composition of the Moon, but only thing is, the rover is designed to travel about half a kilometer away from the lander. So it can scan the lunar surface for about half a kilometer diameter radius around the lander. And not just near the lander, but at that extent also, you would like to know what kind of composition is existing, mineral composition, chemical composition. So that part is being handled by this Alpha Particle X-ray Spectrometer. Then we have laser-induced breakdown spectroscope. So it's like artificially you do a conduct an experiment using a laser and then find out the results so that you can find out what is the abundance of all these elements. You find out the composition, but what kind of abundance of this composition is existing there? Is it useful for your further resource management or not? So it should not be an accidental discovery of any element, but it should be useful again for the future mission. So for that, abundance calculations are necessary. So these are the 14 different instruments, which includes one from USA, yeah, which are going to be sent in this mission.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, as I know that she has just already mentioned, but I wanted to describe, at present, all the countries are rushing to reach the moon. rushing to reach the moon to study the topography and the mineralogy and examine the probability of extracting the minerals from it. Yeah. What do you think will be the consequences of this competition?
The right word to use is that certainly at this particular generation, at this particular scientific go, space race is going on. So if a country is initiating something, immediately the other country is initiating something. And now moon is the center point for all that, because exploration of moon has become a passion, because as madam said, it is like one stop for our future missions.
Yeah.
So we have many future missions coming up. Example, NASA's initiation of sending a manned mission, doing a manned mission to Moon, then Mars, and our own Gaganyaan and MOM. And there are so much, there are so many missions that are coming up that Moon is the center stage for all that. So understanding its topography and mineralogy has become an important aspect of that. So unless and until all the countries are in peace doing all these activities which are going on and mutual exchange of data which is going on currently, because now we can see in Chandrayaan 1 and 2 we have carried few satellites for other countries. Whenever required, there is with mutual consent there is an exchange of data which is going on. Unless and until it is in peace terms, it is very good. But if at all it the space race becomes space racism, then it will be like an end of human race, because we are fighting with this outer world which we do not know, we do not explore. And exploring this will be the data which we get is like a golden treasure for the future generations and innovators, because we are giving them the data of the outer world and we are still exploring what is there out there. Our human tendency is to understand what we do not get. So understanding that is like a greater aspect of human race. And India is playing a major role in that, right? In being one sending these missions and indigenously building some missions. So if we talk about Chandrayaan 2 itself, the whole world is looking towards you. Can they do it? Because 13 payloads only made by them, and they are trying to do something which no other country has done. They are developed countries. They did not attempt it, but we are attempting. The whole world is looking towards us. And if we are successful and get results, what we have sent for, we will definitely make a mark, and they will look forward to us in any future mission. Like Indian role will be a pivotal role in any other mission that other countries plan.
Yeah. What do you think is the importance of this mission to India and to the other world countries? And what do you actually expect from it?
See, expectation is like, an ultimate expectation is like, we have to understand from where we have come from. We are still trying to understand our own solar system. And moon is like, as madam told, it is like a one stop.
Yeah.
And we are searching for water on that. And when such detection has been done by Indian Chandrayaan 1, and we are trying to explore more and get confidence that we have really got, and at what extent is that element available there. If the terrain or if the land mapping, everything suits, maybe in future there will be some space station set up there, and it will be a one stop for future missions like Gaganyaan. And like, we are doing a man-made mission, so we are sending humans there. So we have to have a backup plan. So that would be a backup plan which will be there. And Indian role, like Indian's Chandrayaan 2, will be talked about for further in any other mission, because this is the stepping stone by, this is the starting point which has been taken up by India. So Indian role will be like, from here, if we are successful with the data and whatever we are getting, that will be like, for the future generations, India will be a starting point for all such kind of research.
Ma'am, after the success of Chandrayaan 2, ISRO has announced the solar mission Aditya L1 in 2020. What do you think are the challenges which will come across it?
Basically, we are from astronomy, so we are very much excited with this Aditya L1. And Aditya L1 is basically focused on studying the activities on sun and the impact of all these activities on the planetary regions within inner solar system and outer solar system. So it's not like many other solar exploration satellites. Aditya L1 is going to be placed at a point called as L1. That's how the name comes. It is called as a liberation point or a Lagrangian point. So at this point, that is a point where the gravitational pull, to put it in layman's word, the gravitational pull by Earth and Sun would be balanced. So it would be a point wherein the satellite can travel with a minimum fuel usage without always being dragged by the gravity of either Earth or the Sun. So this L1 point is the point where most of the international satellites are already utilizing. And it is a challenge for our space agency to create, first of all, an instrument which can withstand the rugged interplanetary medium, interplanetary magnetic field, and be exposed to solar radiation, be exposed to other communication networks which may provide a hindrance for our own communication with the Aditya L1. It should provide a different technology by which it can study in the sun's atmosphere in multi-wavelength. Whereas you have SOHO and other satellites which are studying in certain wave bands itself, but Aditya L1 is planned for the multi-wavelength. It's like scanning the whole of the atmosphere once you do these multi-wavelength studies. We assume that the sun is the focus of all of the solar system, and as per astronomy and astronomical theories, when a gas cloud forms into a star, its remnant disk forms into planets and planetoids. So the age of the Earth is equivalent to the age of the sun. Okay. All these planets and all these asteroids, comets, roughly they have born at the same time when the sun was born. And they all have initially formed with the same kind of composition. So if we can find out what kind of impact, what kind of dynamics play inside the sun, which creates such an atmosphere producing such high radiations, there are so many activities like sunspots, flares, prominences, and they produce so much of charged particles, like in solar wind. They produce so much of charged particles which travel through the interplanetary magnetic field, and if not create any biological hazard on the manned spacecrafts, they can definitely create a blackout in the electronics. So when you are having so many satellites set up in space and you are planning so many missions, this information which can be gathered by studying the data of the sun by astronomers can play an important role in deciding what is a tendency of the solar wind which can regulate the near atmosphere, space, near space around the Earth or near space around any other planet, like for Mars also. So if I want to send anything beyond Earth, I need to have complete information about the space environment near those celestial bodies. And I find that there is a strong impact on all the atmospheres near the celestial bodies due to the solar activity. So Aditya L1 plays an important role in understanding what are the periodic events which can take place in the solar surface, solar atmosphere, and how it can create an impact on the interplanetary atmosphere. So that would be a big challenge. As I said, the instruments have to be specifically designed to withstand such kind of harsh conditions, and specifically designed to communicate the information to the Earth observing stations without any hindrance from the other satellites, and be always available in the real time. So that is a big challenge.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. It was a very informative discussion. Thank you for your valuable time and for providing us details about the Chandrayaan-2.